Macmillan Audio presents Iraq Plus 100, the first anthology of science fiction to have emerged from Iraq. Edited by Hassan Blasim. Read for you by Peter Ganim. Introduction. The idea of this book was born in late 2013, amid the chaos and destruction left by the U.S. and British occupation of Iraq, chaos that would drag Iraq into further destruction through Islamic State control over many parts of the country. No nation in modern times has suffered as much as Iraq has suffered. Iraq has not tasted peace, freedom, or stability since the first British invasion of the country in 1914. Since then, Iraqis have lived through a long saga of wars, death, destruction, population displacement, imprisonment, torture, ruin, and tragedies. So, perhaps unsurprisingly, it was difficult to persuade many Iraqi writers to write stories set in the future, when they were already so busy writing about the cruelty, horror, and shock of the present, or trying to delve into the past to reread Iraq's former nightmares and glories. In the process, I personally wrote to most of the writers assembled here in an attempt to encourage them to write for the project. I told them that writing about the future would give them space to breathe outside the narrow confines of today's reality, and that writers needed more space to explore and develop certain ideas and concepts through storytelling. I said they would be writing about a life that is almost unknown, without relying directly on their own experience or their personal reading of the past or the present. Writing about the future can be wonderful and exciting, an opportunity to understand ourselves, our hopes, and our fears by breaking the shackles of time. It's as if you're dreaming about the destiny of man. At first, I was uneasy that we would pull it off. The idea had originally been suggested by my friend and publisher, Ra Page, along the lines of, imagine Iraq 100 years after the U.S. occupation through short fiction. My unease arose from two sources. The first was related to Iraqi literary writing in general, and the second to the literary scene and my personal relationship with it. In an article that dealt with the beginnings of our project, the journalist Mustafa Najjar wrote, "The reluctance of Arab writers to address the future has long been a great mystery, at least to me. The walls of repression and censorship that confine Arab creativity so severely offer in themselves an ideal environment for writing about the future, a space that is free of the taboos that weigh on the past and the present." Iraqi literature suffers from a dire shortage of science fiction writing, and I am close to certain that this book of short stories is the first of its kind, in theme and in form, in the corpus of modern Iraqi literature. Faced with the fact that Iraqi literature lacks science fiction writing, we have tried in this project to open more windows for Iraqi writers. We asked them to write a short story about an Iraqi city 100 years after the start of the occupation, and said they were not required to write science fiction, but had complete freedom to choose any genre of writing that could address the future. We did not select specific writers to take part in the project. We opened the door to anyone who wanted to take part and to imagine an Iraqi city in 100 years, whether academics, novelists, or writers of short stories. There are many possible reasons for this dearth of science fiction writing in Iraqi literature and in Arabic literature in general. Perhaps the most obvious reason is that science fiction in the West was allowed to track the development of actual science from about the middle of the 19th century onwards. The same period was hardly a time of technological growth for Iraqis, languishing under Georgian Mamluk, then returning Ottoman overlords. Indeed, some would say the sun set on Iraqi science centuries before, as it set on their cultural and creative impulses in the wake of the Abbasid Caliphate. What have the subsequent rulers and invaders of Iraq done since then, the cynic might ask, apart from extol the glorious past when Baghdad was the center of light and global knowledge? Knowledge, science, and philosophy have all but been extinguished in Baghdad by the long litany of invaders that have descended on Mesopotamia and destroyed its treasures. In 1258, the Mongol warlord Hulagu set fire to the great library of Baghdad, a place known as the House of Wisdom, where Al-Khwarizmi had invented algebra, Sind ibn Ali had invented the decimal point, and Yaqub ibn Tariq had first calculated the radius of Earth and the other known planets. The library was burnt to the ground. Precious books on philosophy, science, society, and literature were deliberately destroyed. Those that weren't burnt were thrown into the Tigris and the Euphrates by the invaders. The water in the Euphrates is said to have turned blue from all the ink that bled into it from the books. From the Mongol Hulagu to the American Hulagu, George W., this once great seat of learning has been destroyed and pulverized. Bush the Butcher and his partner Blair killed hundreds of thousands in Iraq, and in the process its museums were once again ransacked. All this without mercy or even shame, and in full view of the free world. But let's leave aside Mr. Bush, Mr. Blair, and the other killers still on the loose, and go back to our modest project, which tries to imagine a modern Iraq that has somehow recovered from the West's brutal invasion, in a way that Iraq didn't recover from the Mongol one, in the blink of an eye that is 100 years. Our project tries to imagine the future for this country, where writing, law, religion, art, and agriculture were born, a country that has also produced some of the greatest real-life tragedies in modern times. It is my belief that it is not only science fiction that is missing in modern Iraqi and Arab literature. I share with colleagues the view that Arab literature in general lacks diversity when it comes to genre writing, by which I mean detective novels, fantasy, science fiction, horror, and so on, just as there is little diversity or transparency in our day-to-day lives. We, by which I mean Arabs today, are subservient to form and to narrow-minded thinking because we have been dominated by religious discourse and by repressive practices over long periods, often by dictatorships that served the capitalist West well, bowing to its whims and fitting with its preconceptions. But certainly that does not mean that science fiction is entirely absent from the Arab or Iraqi literary tradition. Reference is often made to the Arab roots and origins of science fiction and fantasy in A Thousand and One Nights, and in Hay ibn Yaqdan, the thought experiment novel written in the 12th century by Ibn Tufayl. Some people trace it to the Sumerians even further back, as the Iraqi writer Adnan al-Mubarak has done on several occasions. Al-Mubarak says, "Modern science fiction is strongly associated with the scientific technological revolution and usually focuses on related issues. On the other hand, science fiction is a literature that is part of a very old tradition that goes back to humanity's first ideas about the real world and about the potential for human beings to constantly explore nature and the world. As is well known, we find the first written material about journeys, including to other planets, in Sumerian literature, the Epic of Gilgamesh, for example, and in Assyrian and Egyptian literature. In an Egyptian text written 4,000 years ago, we read about imaginary journeys to other planets. It is important in this context to go back to Al-Mubarak's essay, How the Sumerians Invented Space Aeronautics. In the middle of the last century, Arabic writers from several Arab countries started to experiment with writing science fiction and fantasy, and Egyptian literature was the dominant presence. But those short stories can be criticized for their references to the supernatural, to spirits, devils, and fairy tales that all fall back on that all-too-dependable myth kitty, A Thousand and One Nights. Hay ibn Yaqdan, on the other hand, met the conditions for writing science fiction in an interesting way, and I believe that modern Arab literature has not paid enough attention to that work, just as it has not shown enough respect for the treasures of Sumerian, ancient Egyptian, or Babylonian writing. Inflexible religious discourse has stifled the Arab imagination, and pride in the Arab poetic tradition has weakened the force and freedom of narration, while invaders and occupiers have shattered the peace that provided a home for the imagination. The picture is not wholly bleak, however. Today there is great hope in a new generation, a generation native to the internet and to globalization. It is a generation that is open-minded, more adventurous about genres, and more impatient to exercise the freedom to express oneself and to experiment. Serious attempts to write science fiction and fantasy have started to appear, especially now that the science is so much easier to get hold of. The internet gives us access to research, to documentaries, and to other novels and books from around the world, and allows us to follow the extraordinary and rapid development of human imagination through science and other forms of knowledge. As for my second, more personal source of unease about editing this anthology, this arose from the fact that I am a writer whose work found its place in the wider, non-Arab world, while I remained on the margins of the Iraqi literary scene, a scene I have always chosen to keep my distance from. Iraqi literature is populated by official writers who belong to the Writers' Union and other cultural institutions. It is a literary scene that depends on personal and cliquey relationships and on the corruption in the press and in the Ministry of Culture. Literary and other cultural projects in Iraq usually come about through personal relationships that are not entirely innocent. Being out in the cold like this comes with its disadvantages, and I have often pressed my editor, Ra Page, to write to Iraqi writers directly and asked him to make some of the selection decisions. If I were the only person in the picture and the sole decision-maker in this project, it might irritate or surprise some Iraqi writers who are more accustomed to literary projects initiated by people from within the narrow circle of usual suspects. The stories collected here have been written by Iraqis from various generations and display a variety of styles. The authors were born and grew up in a variety of cities. Some have abandoned those cities, seeking peace and freedom in exile, while others have chosen to stay on and bear witness to their city's plights to the end. The cities featured here, Baghdad, Basra, Ramadi, Mosul, Sulaymaniyah, Najaf, are all wildly different places, in fiction and reality, but are united by the tragedy of modern Iraq, the tragedy of a people that is desperate for just a solitary draft of peace. As Iraqis, at home and abroad, we are desperate for this peace and thirsty for the imagination and creativity essential to rebuild this ancient country, this land of the two rivers. Hassan Blasim, September 2016, translated by Jonathan Wright. Kahramana by Anoud. The day Kahramana was to be wed to Mullah Hashish, she stabbed him in the right eye and ran to the American annex of Sulaymaniyah. The local media of the Islamic Empire of Wadi Hashish had not yet caught up on the matter. While the rest of the world was using holographics, because maintaining fiber optic cables across water war zones had proved impossible, Wadi Hashish considered anything but paper newspapers printed on metal presses to be Western blasphemy. Plus, the people of Wadi Hashish were never in a hurry. By the time Kahramana had snuck out of the last Wadi Hashish checkpoint, Akhbar Alimera, News of the Empire, had just ran this on their front page. Oh, what a joyous day of jubilation! Allahu Akbar! The Islamic State of Wadi Hashish today wears its festive green and black ribbons on every street lamp. Civil servants have been ordered by the great, the brave lion, the sword of Allah, Amir Mullah Hashish, may Allah reward him in abundance, to cook giant pots of lamb stew at every intersection to feed the poor, as a gesture of his generosity, on the day he is to wed the most beautiful woman in the empire, according to our sisters, as the virtuous Amir, may Allah reward him in abundance, has never laid eyes on a woman before, no other than our blue-eyed sister, Kahramana. The grand wedding reception for men will be held in the courtyard outside Wadi Hashish municipality tomorrow at sunset. Attendance is mandatory. Eat shit, said Lieutenant Abdul Hadi as he tossed the newspaper aside and rubbed its ink off his fingers. NATO in Baghdadistan were the biggest consumers of Akhbar Alimera. They had no idea what happened up north, he thought. Baghdadistan analysts just gobbled up every word those metal printers spat out. It was the only way they could know what Mullah Hashish was up to, since he never went digital. The lieutenant had been sent to the Islamic Empire border under NATO orders. He missed the sandy, sunny, humid climate of Port Basra and hated the bone-dry freezing wind up in this place. Ever since NATO had hit the empire with its sterility gas, it had snowed all year across the northwest side of Iraq, all the way to the Mediterranean. The sterility germs hadn't worked, because the Hashishans were still breeding like cockroaches, only now in 6 feet of snow. At the end of his shift, the lieutenant climbed into his trailer, dropped onto his bed, kicked off his knee-length boots, and sat there, rotating the stiffness out of his ankles. He was staring through the window and letting out deep puffs from a cigarette he'd confiscated, when gradually he realized he was looking at a woman tangled up in the barbed wire. What now, goddammit? He climbed into his boots again, grabbed his machine gun and coat, and walked out toward her. Go back, get back, Abdul Hadi waved at the woman. No Nations Union League trailers here, go away! But she stayed put until he was an arm's stretch away. Then she revealed her face. Her skin was like marble, and she had plump red lips and the nose of a television star. Her face was lightly dotted with pink freckles. Her most prominent features, however, were her dark blue eyes. They sent a shiver through Abdul Hadi, colder than the frostbite in his ink-stained fingers. A strand of her bluish-black hair snuck out of her headscarf and twirled in the breeze. Kahramana was the most beautiful woman Lieutenant Abdul Hadi had ever seen. He had also never seen blue eyes before. I beg you, brother, she interrupted his stare. They will kill me. Her eyes were welling up now. Mesmerized by her, Abdul Hadi clicked back the safety on his firearm, turned his back to her, and gestured with his hand for her to go. Kahramana walked for another day and a half until she saw the blue flag of the NUL. There, she was strip-searched, deliced, and sub-categorized by posture, teeth, size, skin color, and finally by age, before queuing up for fingerprinting, DNA registering, and to have her head shaved. She wept for her long hair. In all her 16 years, this was her very first haircut. But the bald head only made Kahramana's eyes stand out more. They were so prominent that all the women in the
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.